Wine and Cheese headquarters in New York City. I'm Max Dawson, the host of Survivor with All the Fixins podcast. I'm here with my guests, Eliza Orlins and Brian Corridan. Guys, thank you for joining me. Actually,
absolutely.
Thank you for hosting me.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, welcome.
Welcome to my home.
To your home, and also to the clubhouse of the Wine and Cheese.
The headquarters.
I think clubhouse is kind of dismissive. Headquarters makes it sound much more important. So headquarters, you'll have to bear with me. I don't have a voice from screaming last night at the Survivor Live Know-It-Alls event.
I know. I can't believe you missed it. It was so much drama.
Eliza was yelling a lot, too.
I'm going to hear about the fight with Dan, by the way.
Yes. Should we dive right into that?
Do you want to dive into that first?
Let's dive right into that.
Oh, gosh. Wait, actually, I think that Brian has something he needs to introduce. This has to be the start of our, because wine and cheese,
as you know,
we can't be wine and cheese without wine.
So I got a special bottle of wine for tonight's broadcast. This is a Yellowtail Shiraz because Shiraz has a lot of the same letters as Shireen.
Aww.
And Shireen was voted
Shireen.
Out. And then second, it's an Australian, and my two favorite players are Jeff and Kimmy.
Very good.
And
look
I mean
at
also
this.
Stephen Fishback, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, Jeff and Kimmy and Shireen in one bottle.
This is
Stephen's
the sort of
your real life friend.
Stephen's my real
you
life
are
friend.
A fan okay. of Jeff and Kimmy.
You hold this.
Okay.
Correct. Stephen is my friend. Kimmy is my secret love.
And this is the sort of high-level intellectualizing that takes place at Wine and Cheese, I would imagine.
You don't just bring any wine to Wine and Cheese.
No, let's actually dive into that. Before we get into last night, before we get into the episode, people want to know about Wine and Cheese. People want to know who's in it, how you get in it. Do you have to be beaten in, like when you join the Crips or the Bloods? Have people been kicked out? You know, what sort of wine? What sort of cheese? And the very important question of, has anyone ever brought the wrong wine or the wrong cheese. So let's start at the beginning. What is wine and cheese for the uninitiated?
So we didn't name it that. That was never a thing that we came up with. I actually think it was Rob Sesternino who started calling us wine and cheese because wine and cheese was a thing that frequently showed up at our
get-togethers.
We called ourselves the New York City Survivors. That's literally what we were. We were the New York City Survivors. Nobody ever dubbed
us
anything.
Just you and me, by the way.
It was the two of us.
For season, like after my season.
For multiple seasons. And then Courtney Yates joined us.
Yep.
And then
we're gonna forget people. It's gonna be embarrassing.
I know, but anyhow. And then we had Sarah Leshner from who was Amazing Race. And then we had other people joined.
Steven. And soon after that.
Yeah, and it just grew to New York City Survivors. We all get together to watch the show. And it wasn't this click thing.
It was
until
social media kind of took it off. I guess we would post about it. You would tweet about it because I wasn't on Twitter for the longest time. And they kind of gave us this idea of this New York City snotty,
I know,
elitist, obnoxious, oops, liberal wine and cheese.
And
group.
You just ran with
and,
it.
And you know what? And then it's like Charlie Herschel. One of the things, people were like, between that whole group, we have X number of graduate degrees and X number. And it's just Ivy Leaguers and all these. And it was just this is what, it just became this kind of thing that we didn't even ever anticipate
it.
And now there's a shirt. That wine and cheese with a fish. Yes. Did you see that shirt?
I did. Yeah, yeah.
So cute.
We should be wearing that, actually.
I know. Sorry.
Sorry, I have to cough. Oh, my God. So let's talk a little bit more about this. You talked a little bit about the genesis of the wine and cheese, current and past members. Let's talk about, future Survivor seasons. Inevitably, there may be people from New York or the tri-state area who are fans of the show. Mm-hmm. Let's run through some hypothetical situations. Say there's a guy who's on a future season, but he voted for Mitt Romney. Can he be in the Wine and Cheese?
Yeah.
Okay. Probably not.
I mean...
And honestly, I mean, just because I happen to be the person who hosts them at my home... Mm-hmm. I guess I kind of am the arbiter of...
Yeah, it's sort of Eliza allows in or
I mean,
out.
It's either I am kind of the doorkeeper. I mean, and then there have been people who have kind of wormed their way
but
in.
I like Terry, though, and I feel like Terry probably voted for Mitt Romney.
Terry would be welcome at Wine and Cheese.
Yeah, of course.
Terry Dietz, you are always welcome. You really? And me, we've got a thing. I love that guy.
An avatar of the military industrial complex?
No, I love that guy. If he'd been on Fans vs. Favorites 1, we 100% would have been an alliance.
Okay.
He was supposed to be on the show. I would have been with him all the way. I love that guy.
Okay, what's the story behind that? I don't know that story.
I mean, it's the same thing that happened to many, many of these second chancers many times. They got cut last minute. They were all supposed to be on Fans vs. Favorites 1, Fans vs. Favorites 2, Blood vs. Water, this, that, you know.
Heroes, villains.
Mm-hmm. Like, people who got cut last minute, who, like, have had many times when they've been, like, told that they were going to be on the show.
Okay, what about a state school? If someone went to a state school, could they be in Wine and Cheese?
Where did Courtney go to college? I don't even know.
Yeah, that's not a thing. That's not a thing.
You know, but it also depends which.
How about a Mormon? Could a Mormon be in Wine and Cheese?
Todd?
Todd? Rafe was a Mormon?
Absolutely. Rafe would be welcome.
If I saw Nalia, I would like demand that she come hang out with us.
Now, what about someone who was uncomfortable with a small dog copulating with a pillow?
Well, that would be problematic.
That characterizes half of us.
Oscar?
Already.
You guys could only see what we are seeing.
Come here.
Right now. No, don't make
him
stop.
That's enough. Yeah, I don't know what he...
That's his love pillow.
Yeah.
No, it isn't. That is not his love pillow. Well, you are not supposed to be humping that pillow.
If it's not his love pillow, it should be no one's pillow. No, because it is most
Oscar,
definitely a
pillow.
Note
to future attendees of Wine and Cheese screening parties, avoid the yellow pillow. Definitely avoid the yellow pillow. Just a few more questions about Wine and Cheese, because I want to satisfy the audience's curiosity. Let's talk about people who maybe have been asked to leave and Cheese. Has there ever been an instance where there's been a fracture within the group?
I'll let you deal with that one.
Well, there was a temporary...
A sabbatical?
Hiatus.
So to say?
Suspension. I'll call it a suspension.
Suspension.
There was
okay.
a temporary suspension because an individual betrayed another individual.
It was
in
highly
Wine and
publicized
Cheese.
on social media.
But you know what? She served her suspension with dignity and class, and now she's welcome back.
She's awesome, by the way. I mean, everyone knows, obviously, it's referring to Andrew voting out Franny, which you were not pleased about. Andrew's fantastic.
Yeah.
I love her.
She is back
Andrew
within
is
your
back
good
in.
Graces.
Yep.
And what did it take for her? Was there some sort of re-education program? Or
re-education through labor?
6-hour video ceremony. You just have to like watch how not to vote.
You have to like clean your apartment or.
No. But we all kind of made amends on both sides.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
I don't think she went to an Ivy League school or to a top rated private institution. That could have been the problem. You could have nipped that problem in the bud if you had just
Max is making this worse.
I know, Max. No, by the way, you went to Brown, if I'm correct. So
hell yeah, I did. That's why I'm allowed at the Wine and Cheese parties. That's why I'm an honorary member.
All right.
Maybe we should actually get on topic and talk about Survivor.
Oh yes, but what about the fight with Dan?
Okay, well, yes, before we get on topic, let's talk a little bit about the reason why I'm in town. Well, I'm in town for work, but I also am in town because I attended last night Rob Sesternino's live know-it-alls event at Caroline's Comedy Club. Eliza was in attendance. Who else was there?
Franny, Andrea, Mike Snow, Bryce.
What was Bryce doing? He's not
Dan Foley. He lives in Philly, so he just came down, I think.
Correct.
Yeah, he just came up. Mm-hmm. Who did I forget?
Whoever we forgot.
Eric Stein from Big Brother.
Eric Stein from Big Brother. Smaller turnout, I feel like, than perhaps in the past, right?
Yeah.
Surprising given the season.
I know. I think, like, you know, our New Yorkers, people have their own things going on, like, you know, Steven's in Mongolia.
I was working.
Is Mongolia just code for Steven's afraid to come out in public right now?
No, he's actually in Mongolia.
He
but
took
I think
a long
he
time
may
to get back on Twitter.
He definitely did.
He may or may not have gone to Mongolia for the reasons
such as
I don't know. I think he. I think he's. You know, he's not happy about. He's ready for this to be over. This whole ordeal.
I just want to hug him. I just want to hold Steven and hug him.
It's weird, though. It's weird. You know. I wonder if I'm not supposed to disclose this.
Then just don't.
Well, like, hold on. Whisper it to me first, off mic. I mean,
you know what? I'm going to say it because I think it's not a spoiler. It's not a spoiler.
It's not
a spoiler.
Not a spoiler.
No spoilers basically, on the All the Fixins podcast.
Basically, the scene where you see Steven, basically, it looks like Steven says to the whole group, hey, maybe Jeremy's off looking for an idol, you know, when he's like off missing Val.
Quotes.
And I put air quotes Val. Missing Val. I don't know. Is that really? Like, he's been gone for like a week.
She's pregnant. I'll give him that.
Anyhow, when Steven said that, he said it in private conversations. He did not say it in that the audio was from a different conversation, and he didn't say it to the whole group. So I wonder why they're giving him this dopey, like, clueless edit.
Don't we all know that's what we sign up? I mean, of course they're going to give Steven the dopey edit because he's on a team against Joe and Jeremy and Savage. Oh, Savage. Mm. You know who we need this season? We need Lil Morris.
Well, Steven might be the Lil Morris.
I hope
this
he is
season.
The Lil Morris.
I hope so too.
All I wanted was just Lil making pouty face as Savage told his story. Like, that's all I wanted was just Lil being like,
yeah, also, I was like, really like when thinking, Rob said that thing about, so Rob said last night, he goes, so Savage is telling that story. And I think to myself, oh my God, like, his wife must have died.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
that story was not like a I miss my wife story. It was a story about how he steals his 22-year-old hot wife from his friend who brings her to visit, and the friend is like in love with her. And then he steals her away. And everyone's like, so romantic. And it's like, what the fuck are you guys talking about?
Yeah.
Fucking insane.
And what kind of narcissist tells the story about meeting his significant other and then is so mortally offended when someone else doesn't weep openly about it? Steven asks this question about the million-dollar game they're all involved in, and Savage then goes on a diatribe about Steven has no morals.
Morals.
No
I know.
Courage. He essentially says everything he could to suggest that Steven isn't a real man.
Yeah.
Without saying Steven isn't a real man.
So is Steven the Lil or is Steven the Ryan Shoulders?
I don't know. I'm curious to hear what the audience thinks. If we have actually anyone listening right now, is Steven Fishback the Lil or the Ryan Shoulders of Second Chances? Or is he just the John Cochran? Because I do see Steven being set up in the Revenge of the Nerds sort of situation where by the end of the season, I want to see Steven playing an idol and taking Savage out or leading some sort of blindside counter maneuver against Savage or something
like
that.
Well, the difference though between Steven and John Cochran is that Cochran always got the kind of...
Eliza likes one of them, but she doesn't like the other.
That's one of the many differences between them. Cochran got the kind of dopey edit of, oh, this little kid, he's so fish out of water. Look at him and him sunburn. Where Steven's getting the edit of this guy's smart and calculating. It's CPN versus CPP, you know?
Ooh.
Ah.
No, edging. He wasn't getting...
Cochran?
Yeah.
Well, if anything, he was getting OTTP.
Yeah, definitely OTTP.
And that is why Brian Corridan is such a fan favorite. And it's why I have always geeked out over hanging out with him. He's because he drops OTTN or CPP into conversation.
I participated in Edgic one season, the whole season. I like would rank people every week and do the
really?
Whole thing. Oh, yeah.
I mean, I was CPP by the end of my season.
Congratulations.
I don't mean to brag, but I hope you guys feel ashamed.
As an OTTN.
I was fully OTTN. OTTN for the win.
Yes. I'll toast to that.
To that.
Yeah, this is my glass.
I won't because I was CPP.
To all the OTTNs out there, this is for you guys.
And I maintain that in my everyday life. I try to be OTTN.
You were very OTTN last night.
I sure was.
So we're on the subject of Steven versus Savage, which is one of the major themes through two episodes of this still young season. What do we see here? What's going on? Eliza, talk a little bit about why you were vocally an exponent of a new hashtag.
Yeah,
involving
I know. I've gotten
Savage.
So many. So I said the hashtag of the evening should be hashtag fuck Andrew Savage.
Oh.
And so I've gotten so many tweets today with like hashtag fuck Andrew Savage. I agree. And basically, you know, this guy who's like, I mean, it's so amazing. Like, you know what he is? He's coach. He is fully coach. He's this delusional, narcissistic lunatic who just happens to also kind of be a little bit more handsome and normal looking and
successful
and
intelligent.
Has a law degree, which beats me. I don't know how he got it. What school gave him a law degree? Can somebody tweet me that? Can you look that up and let me know? But like Savage is like this guy who is such, I don't know why he's been so beloved. Like I didn't even necessarily want to see him.
You remember who is his number one proponent.
Yeah, of course, Jeff Probst.
Right, Jeff Probst.
But that's why I think I hate everyone who Jeff Probst loves.
I mean,
on the show. I mean, I sometimes, yeah, pretty much. I mean, like Cochran, Boston Rob, like all these coach, like these people who he like holds up in this like.
No, you like Boss Rob though.
In person.
Not on the show. I love Boss Rob on the show.
That season that they just made for him to win, yeah, I fucking hated
good,
that.
Though the season was horrible. He was.
Yeah,
good.
I guess that's true. But it was just so horrible to watch, like a season that's just like so dull.
So what is Savage?
God, if Savage wins, I'm going to be so pissed.
With Fishback? What is his problem with Fishback? We know that he said coming into the season, he had looked on the Survivor Wiki and learned that Steven was devious. I don't know who updated the Survivor Wiki. Was he? I don't think
Steven
so.
Steven was incredibly loyal.
He was loyal. Like,
devious.
Incredibly loyal.
He was so loyal that he lost the game.
Right. He should have been a little bit less loyal.
Yes.
Taking Aaron Lobdell.
Steven is someone who, if you know him in real life,
I love you,
know
Aaron.
Him to be
I love you. Aaron Moss.
Thoughtful, considerate, personable, friendly, a great conversationalist, someone who's very easy to talk to. Savage comes in, though, with a hard-on for him. Like, who is this fish guy? Who
fish
is
Fish Bach.
Fish Bach. That needs to stop.
And,
I know.
And to me, one of the things I see is, in Survivor, very often, early in the game, people target people for being different. Different from them.
As in life.
Different from them in that their skin color is a different color. Mm-hmm. Or maybe that they are from a different region. They worship a different god. Or they vote a different way. And for some reason, Savage is a coastal lawyer. He lives in the Bay Area. He works for Yahoo. But when I see him looking at Fishback, I see him looking at someone who offends him. And partially because he doesn't exemplify the sort of masculine ideal mm-hmm. that Savage upholds himself to and wants to surround
Which
himself
with.
Which
is why he has such a hard on for Jeremy, because like they are like
Joe. Using the word hard on.
I know.
Hard on. Ways.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of hard ons on that side.
He has a massive man crush on Jeremy in that I think, you know, he's like, my God, those are my people. Yeah. He feels akin. You know, the same way I feel a kinship with people like Shireen and people like Steven and, you know, us brainy nerds from, you know, East Coast, West Coast, like we have to stick together. And then it's like these type A male domination jerks for law school. At what?
At Plan Voodoo.
Oh. Apparently Savage graduated from the University of Cincinnati Law School, which apparently is a real law school.
Listen.
Cincinnati. You know Sash is from Cincinnati.
I love Sash.
I think. Or is he? He lives around that area.
Is Sash honorary wine and cheese?
Yeah.
Oh, Sash is. Sash was fully wine and cheese, honorary.
He moved out to Chicago.
He left us. He was not exiled. He left us. He ditched us for Ohio.
RC was definitely never exiled.
No, RC was never kicked out. Somebody asked me if RC was kicked out of Wine and Cheese. RC was not. She just has been really busy, hasn't been able to come lately. She usually comes and bakes cupcakes. So.
And I'm not sure how much she'd love watching Abby anyway.
Yeah, right. I was just going to say, speaking of RC,
I think she's avoiding this season a little.
Is anyone thinking differently about RC now? I mean, you guys know her. I know her. It's not changing our opinions that much, but maybe people in the audience, seeing Abby pull many of the same shenanigans, this time just conveniently slotting PG into that role, you feel a little bit of a pang of sympathy for
RC.
I don't
think PG will be the last person in that role if Abby sticks around. Like, I think this is going to be a pattern that is just, you're going to see, what did she call herself? The Brazilian dragon, you know, coming out this whole season. I mean,
how long can Abby last?
Is she doing this on purpose, or is this just the tiger that can't lose her stripes?
I think she is who she is.
Yeah. And I don't actually, watching her, I think she tried. I actually think she deliberately tried to kind of not lose her cool. I felt for Abby. Is this weird? Am I in the wrong company to say I feel for Abby?
No, not at all.
Because
you might not be invited to the next Wine and Cheese party,
Brian couldn't do anything to get kicked out of Wine and Cheese. He's an integral founding member and he's here to stay.
Vote for Donald Trump.
I mean,
it would never happen.
It just wouldn't happen.
What if he did it just to test you?
No, it wouldn't happen.
Okay. I think that we
even if he told me he was like, Eliza, I voted for Donald Trump, I'd be like, I don't believe you.
I don't believe you. You should have to stand in the booth with me.
Which is illegal.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, you can't bring someone in the booth.
Really? Your kids? Anyway. Maybe Abby. Your kids. Abby. I
brought
kind
Oscar.
Of liked Abby. I was like, I felt for her. I loved Terry's move. I felt like Terry's showing growth.
Look at Terry. I know.
I think Abby's showing growth. Well, Abby's trying to grow. But how easy is it to grow in Survivor?
I know. Well, one of the big things we were talking about last night was can a leopard change its spots?
Can a leopard change its spots?
Because it was like, you know, Jeff called out Spencer for being the exact same position as he was last time. Shireen for being in the same position. You know, people mm-hmm. who, and he's like, are you just the same every time you play Survivor? It's hard to play differently the next time.
Also, let's remember both, Spencer has not, despite his claims that he has aged a lot, he's gone from what, 21 to 23, 2.5? Like he hasn't grown as much as he maybe thinks he has, literally growth. Shireen was just on last season. What, she didn't have time to grow, which is why I think you're seeing people like Terry adjust his game a little bit better. And maybe that's the only example I have. I didn't think this through before I started speaking.
Well, you know, to this question of is it possible to change? It's possible to change, but maybe starving on an island on a televised game show is not the place to do that. Mm-hmm. So people like Varner or Kimmy or Terry, who've had 10, 12 years, 6, 8 years to evaluate their game, to grow, to put in the hard work, maybe they have the opportunity to change, play differently. But Spencer,
I had five
Shireen,
years between games.
Okay, so how did that help you or did it?
I don't know that it did, to be perfectly honest. I mean, if we're going to just be honest here, like I think I maybe made some of the same mistakes the second time around as I did the first time around. Because I kind of, I think I can admit that I, when I'm on the game of Survivor, like I'm a really paranoid person. Like it's so hard for me to do the thing that everybody was talking about this episode, which is just bond with people on an emotional level and just connect with them, which is something that I think I'm actually fairly decent at in real life.
Yeah.
However, on Survivor, I'm like, okay, but who's voting for who? Where's this person? Why'd they go off together? I think those two people just walked off together. Oh my God. Oh my God. Where are those people? Like, and I'm just like freaking psycho.
There was a clip of Kelly Wigglesworth on Entertainment Weekly where she talks about how the first couple days, she just feels like all of the socialness is fake. And I think that's how very much how I would feel. If you like coming up to me on day 12, like day one or day two, and you say, oh, so what do you do? Who are you? Where are you? I'm like, you know, like this is like your awkward attempt at building a bridge. Like, I don't know. It's not organic.
But is that just in a returning season or is that for you as well in Guatemala? Is that how you felt?
Maybe it is a returning season. That's interesting because I think in Guatemala, you actually are like, I legit don't know you. Like, I do not know who you are. What do you do? So I think in a returning season, it maybe comes across a little bit more phony to ask superficial questions.
Right. You're like,
well, let's talk about the returning player issue. Oh, by the way, is that thing?
It is.
What is that thing? You don't want to talk about it?
You've seen Future Shades of Grey. You know what it is.
Okay.
I'm kidding.
It's
Oh, it's the buck.
The buck.
Yeah.
Who's is that?
Rhino.
Rhino.
We should do push-ups on it. He would be so happy.
Rhino, we're going to do push-ups on the buck in a little while. I know Rhino's watching. Rhino is a friend of the podcast. So Rhino, we are going to get on the buck in a little while. The buck is a workout apparatus.
It's the workout thing.
Oh, okay.
Let's talk about returning player seasons. Eliza, you played on one.
I did.
I had two players on one as well.
Yeah. What is different coming into the game for these players, apart from the theme, apart from the imperative to demonstrate change and growth that the theme sets up? What sort of advantages do they have? What sort of disadvantages do you feel like the players are experiencing?
Well, on a mixed season, a season mixed with newbies and returners, they automatically gain a reverence that carries them a bit through. You know, we've never seen a mixed season of returners and newbies where the newbies vote out the returner soon on, except for Russell Swan, but they were down to three people at that point. You know, I think that when you are a returner, Oscar, when you are a returner on a group with newbies, the newbies will just gravitate towards you and listen to you.
Right. No. Oh, actually, that's not true. Sophie won on a season that had, she was up against a returner.
No, she won, but Coach and Ozzy both made it to the final five.
True.
So I don't think that you're going to see returning players be voted out by newbies because of the respect.
Do you ever feel like in returning player season, other factors are coming into the vote? Now, we know of, for example, off-island alliances and relationships, but also this is something I asked Corinne last week. The vote to take out someone, not just because they're a threat, but because they're taking away your screen time.
Oh, I love it.
Oh my gosh.
You played with one of the biggest screen time black holes of all time.
Yeah. It didn't occur to me. That wasn't sort of something I thought about when I played the game. I'm so innocent.
No, I mean, it occurred to me for sure because I was on a season with like
Johnny Fairplay,
Yao Man, Sari, Fairplay, Ozzy, James, Parvati. I mean, these are people who are big characters. I mean, who've come back time and time again. But it never occurred to me that they would take my screen time because I know that on any season I'm on, I will be the narrator because I just form sentences.
And you're probably just there better to be on the jury anyways for the patented Eliza faces. I mean, as soon as Memerge hits,
I almost didn't make the jury.
You're checking out.
Almost didn't make it. But I'm not checking out. But I think that it was never like, oh, we should get rid of this person because they're going to take my airtime.
Did Corinne think otherwise on Fans for Sarah 2?
Well, you know, she had the unenviable experience of playing with Philip Cochran,
yes,
and Brandon.
Yikes.
That
pre-merge was terrible.
They remove all of the oxygen from the Survivor universe by, you know, just the sheer force of their personalities, leaving very little time or room for anyone else.
Yeah.
Especially at the reunion.
Well, great comment by Rob last night. We have more survivors on stage than were at the Caramon reunion.
Because Franny and Mike Snow were on stage at the same time.
And Andrea was there as well.
And Andrea,
Let's get back to the season at hand.
At Oscar Orlins, you guys. Look, at Oscar Orlins.
Oscar, are you moving on to a new pillow? Does the yellow pillow know that you're... Oh, you're done. You finished.
Look at him. He's,
in the refractory state now. He's just mellow now. Want to have a smoke.
I mean, he's just hanging out with us now. Little ass.
Who is impressing you right now in this season?
Terry.
Okay.
I like Terry. I think he's really stepped up his game. I love that he took care of Abby. I love Varner.
I love Varner.
I love Varner. I love him.
Can Varner be on every season?
I love him.
I think Varner should just have a show.
He needs a foil. Varner's not great until he has a foil.
It's true.
No, Varner's good against people he doesn't like.
But he's good with every single person. He goes to Terry and he works Terry perfectly. Yeah. He goes to Shireen and Spencer. He not only works them, but he creates entertainment out of every interaction.
Oh my God. What bit my ass?
I was going to say, Brian, how dare you?
No, it just Varner.
Yeah, oh I mean, God. Varner is definitely
that guy.
The odds-on pick for most soup appearances this season.
Yeah.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, and just
fan favorite.
I already am excited for his third time. Like, you know, whether he wins this season or whether he goes out early,
I just
want Varner to be a part of this, more of a part of the Survivor.
They must be like, how did we not bring him back sooner?
They asked that, and Dalton Ross asked that in a Tim Weekly, and Jeff's like, he's always at the top of our list. I'm like,
no, he's not. Yes, so we had to bring back Rupert a fourth time before we could bring him back. Well, thank God they finally did.
We love him. And the fans voted him on. I was worried for him.
Yeah.
I'm a big advocate of those old school survivors.
We love them.
That said, as much as I love the old school survivors, Kelly Wentworth is hot out of the
gate. Oh my God, I know.
Love her.
Kelly Wentworth, like, where was this Kelly Wentworth the first time around?
She was saddled by her dad. Didn't you hear the 18 times she said it?
I know. Saddled by her dad. It's so gross. Stop saying it.
You were like, I feel the story is that all fans versus favorite or blood versus water seasons are like just the narrative is the albatross of your loved one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's completely
true. Well, Vetus had to talk about that.
Sierra and her mom, Laura Morris.
Jeremy trying to play. Now I can play without having to worry about my wife. Please just say blood versus water seasons are behind us.
Can we just real quick, the burden of playing with your wife. Oh, the wife who was out on day 6, that wife, do you mean?
Yeah, you were so burdened.
Do you mean Val, who was gone before the week had ended? Val?
Tyson, I don't think Tyson talks about what a burden Rachel was. I mean, Rachel was out immediately. Well, exactly. Like,
Versus water is a convenient excuse for why you didn't do better than you wanted to do.
Right.
And it's a convenient excuse for why there are two really weird outlier seasons of Survivor that hopefully we'll never return to. I don't like that concept.
Either blood versus water season, you like it all.
You know what? I don't. I mean, the first one I think gave us some great characters.
Reed and Josh are part of Wine and Cheese.
Reed and Josh are part of Wine and Cheese.
Yeah. And they were on a blood versus water season. It's very tolerant of you guys.
Well,
not even real Survivor.
Well, just in case, because you were saying
the
tri-state area.
For those two?
The tri-state area. Neither. They're both winners.
They're both doves.
They are.
They're both doves.
They are. Natalie and Nadia live in the tri-state area.
But they are not Wine and Cheese.
No.
That's correct.
Why is that? Oh, Bridge and Tunnel.
And Tunnel.
So if you live over the Hudson, No wine and cheese.
No wine and cheese.
Well, is that what it is?
Pretty much.
Just I don't know. If you moved to Jersey City, I would still invite you to wine That's and
true.
Cheese.
That's true.
But what if Natalie and Nadia moved into your building and were upstairs or something?
I don't think they would come, to be honest.
Why is that?
I kind of invited them one time. I was like, oh yeah, if you guys, because they were like, they were in for Rob Has a Podcast last year. And they were like, oh yeah, you guys all watch the show together. I'm like, yeah, you guys should come sometime. And they like have my number and everything.
Twinnies, if you're listening, and I know you are, come to the wine and cheese. I'm actually very sad that we didn't see the Twinnies last night. I thought they were going to be there. I love me so some too. Twinnies. I loved to hate Twinnies on Amazing Race. As soon as I saw them on Survivor, I said, vote them out immediately. By the end of the season, I was just over the moon for Natalie. And now having met them in person, they are so much fun. They are so much energy. I understand why they have to be at every single CBS reality show from now on. So I think you should give them a shot. Give them a trial membership.
I invited them. Listen, I think they turned me down. Oh. That was, you know.
Ooh. We'll see. We'll see. It could be that they have a little bit of a relationship with Missy and Baylor, and they know that you could either be a Missy and Baylor person or a Reed and Josh person.
Who are Missy and Baylor? Were they? Oh, my God, they were on Survivor. Oh, I know who you're talking about. Those really conservative, stupid, annoying people.
Her song, Baylor's song. What was the title?
Popcorn something?
No.
I have no idea.
Missy.
Sticky situation.
And Baylor are lovely people. Sticky situation. They hosted me in Dallas not too long ago. They were very kind to me.
Tight with Mike, as I see on social media.
Missy is a lovely lady.
Uh-huh.
I'm just going to change the subject.
Okay.
Okay, moving on. So we were talking about who is impressing us. They were not invited to John and Jacqueline's wedding. Okay.
I'm just saying, John and Jacqueline played with them.
This is getting a little uncomfortable. So you were about to say someone else who you were impressed by. Were you going to stick with the Australia theme? I know you were happy to see Kimmy. Talk a little bit about Kimmy.
We haven't seen her do much.
I wish we were getting more from Kimmy. Kimmy, I was 17 when Australia aired. I was an impressionable 17-year-old. Kimmy comes on episode one. She's like, but where am I going to masturbate? And I'm like, this chick.
Yes.
This one.
Well, apparently Colby found you could just go walk off a little bit and rub one out on the trail.
Did Colby do that?
I don't know. Did I just make that up?
Are we spreading rumors about Colby Donaldson?
Is that
not a thing I've ever heard, Max?
Listeners, randomly. Somebody please confirm.
Oh, my God.
Did Colby Donaldson rub one out in Survivor to the Australian Outback?
What?
I'm sure someone out there knows.
I have never heard this rumor, and I've heard like every Survivor rumor ever, Max.
I don't know. Maybe this is just something that probes dreamed up.
Oh, my God.
So, I love Kimmy. I love the chicken fight. I love the worm situation. I love everything about her.
Oh, my God.
She was so misplaced on the show, which made her fantastic. And with all my heart, I wanted her to get on. We were watching the live reveal here.
Yes.
And Parvati.
I think I have a video somewhere of Brian
like screaming out
when they announced that Kimmy Capenberg made it. And like,
everybody's like,
I mean,
making fun of me.
It was so funny. I think that was my favorite wine and cheese party ever in the history
really
of wine and cheese parties.
Party.
That was Survivor finale last season when they revealed the cast.
Yeah, that was a great night.
Whatever. You didn't. You wouldn't have wanted to be on this season.
Soccer.
You got that right. I would be having a horrible vacation in Vietnam right. Well, not right now, but in this portion of the season because I would have been the first or second out. So Kimmy, we love her, but not enough from Kimmy.
And I'm worried that she's either going to be dumped early because, you know, it's Kimmy, or she's going to be drug along as like a goat who doesn't make decisions. I want to see Kimmy come in with like guns blazing. I want to see Kimmy do what Kelly Wentworth is doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Kelly Wentworth has really like turned it around. She's impressing me.
Turned around the opinions of the Survivor universe. I mean, there were a lot of people who wanted to see what she had.
Yeah.
A lot of people who believed in her. And then
look,
there were just
I'm
as many
a
naysayers.
A pre-merger is getting a second chance. Obviously.
Brian, for second chances.
There have been some people who've written in and have said, you know, when's Brian going to get a second chance? You're available.
I'm here. Call
let's
me.
Let's okay.
I'm
let's
not doing anything.
Let's look into the camera and make your appeal. Okay. When I went in for second chances, they sat us in front of the camera. They said, tell us your story, why you deserve a second chance.
Why wouldn't you put me back on? I'm articulate.
Talk to America.
I love the game. I watch the show. I narrate. I know the people. I'm still connected. There's no reason not to. You're fools. You're fools, Lynn and Jeff. Damn fools. They're not going to put me back on. They don't like Guatemala. It's a Guatemala thing.
What is the rub with Guatemala?
What is?
Why no deal? Guatemala returners?
I can't believe Judd has never been brought back. Yeah. I can't believe. I mean, Judd was Jamie. Such a character. By the
would
way,
would you let Judd in Wine and Cheese?
Yeah.
Of course. And his wife, Kristen.
I would let Judd and Kristen in. They do their own thing, I think. Yeah. Judd works in Manhattan, though.
Yeah,
Judd
no, I know.
Brooke Garrity, Vanuatu, first boot of Vanuatu, who is a dear friend of mine.
I just met him the other day.
Was in New York, and he, that's right, because he was in LA right before he came to New York.
Awesome.
He's amazing. He was like, yeah, I got off the plane and, you know, took a train to Penn Station, and then I walked up to 50th Street and went to Judd's hotel to see if he was still there. And there was Judd, like,
so, yeah.
Standing, doing his doorman thing.
And probably, you know,
Wellington. Super Judd. Psyched to probably. See Brooke. They like bonded, you know, mm-hmm. We used to all hang out at the olden days at the Survivor events and
calling guests scumbags and, you know,
by freaking alligators, man.
So really though, what do you think is the problem with Guatemala?
I think
why
it's just
the stigma?
Utterly forgettable season by the producers because it wasn't the story of Stephanie coming back and winning.
So when Stephanie didn't win, they lost interest.
It's because your winner is Danny, who barely spoke to the camera.
Well, also Danny
strategy.
Boatwright, because Danny had a fundamental understanding of
producers. Yeah.
Yeah. And
Danny knew what she was doing.
And she knew that if she wanted to win, she had to not exactly tell them what everything that was going on. And so she didn't. And that's how she won.
Brilliant. Brilliant gameplay.
But,
you know, in a season where you feel
like.
But
makes bad TV.
Bad TV.
Makes
but
bad
brilliant
TV.
Gameplay when you feel like things may be teed up for Stephanie.
Guatemala ended with a lot of people who just aren't going to return. You're not going to get Lydia back. Rafe worked for another television network for a long time, so he was ineligible. Stephanie, they brought back for Heroes vs. Villains. Danny, I think for a while, didn't want to do it. Judd, I don't know why they didn't bring Judd back. Gary, I don't think would do it again. So your end game players in Guatemala, I just don't think would do it again. I think you're, you know what we should do? Is
what's
a
that?
Battle of the seasons and bring me and Amy together, or Brooke. Me, Amy, or Brooke. Just like some pre-merge people from Guatemala. And we'll just play as one
person. You
guys
are the best. You guys
just like the
totally
three of
get
us,
it.
Me, Amy, and Brooke, one person will play together.
Somebody tweeted how cute Oscar
Amy
was.
And I are nuts. Like, we make no sense together. We don't get along in the game. We didn't like each other in the game. But now we're like this. And it would be a comedic odd couple. And I think Amy and I should play together.
Totally.
Well, fans, if you're out there and you are clamoring like I am for a Brian Corridan return, please tweet at Survivor Tweet, tweet at Jeff Probst, write letters, you know, call your congressperson, and let them know. It's time to see someone come back from Guatemala, and it's time to see this guy come back.
I'd love to see anybody come back, but especially me.
Well, not anybody.
So should we start taking questions, guys?
Yeah, let's start taking some listener questions. We've been collecting questions all day on the Survivor ATF hashtag. Thank you for your questions. I know that there are a number of questions that people had for Eliza about last night. We still haven't gotten into what went down with you and Dan Foley. So before we get into the questions, why don't you tell the story of what went down?
I guess we're going to do this then.
We're going to do this. This is Survivor with all the fixes.
So
we
basically,
don't back off.
So basically what happened was we're sitting there. Rob Sesternino had reserved like the front center tables for us to watch the show. So I'm sitting with Franny and Andrea and Mike Snow and Eric Stein. And we're sitting at one table. And Max and Dan Foley and a couple other people are right at the table right behind us. And we're watching the show. And it comes to the immunity challenge. And this is right when Shireen is subbed in to do the puzzle. And Dan starts going, what a terrible idea. That's so stupid. And I'm like, what? And so like, I kind of tried to ignore it, at least not to disrupt the show.
To be fair, they did lose.
But I mean, barely. I mean, it was the direction it was facing. Listen, I don't think that, I thought Shireen did a good job on the puzzle. But anyhow, it's kind of irrelevant whether or not she was going to do a terrible job or not, but like, just don't laugh at like someone who everyone here, we're all friends with her. Like, we like her very much. Like, don't come to a Survivor event in New York City and make fun of one of our friends. Like, that's just not an acceptable thing to do. So the commercial break starts and I turn around and I'm like, by the way, like, that's not acceptable. Like, don't be an asshole. And, you know, nobody here is okay with that. And I'm just speaking up for the group. Like, don't fucking talk shit about Shireen. And Dan's like, what about you? You fucking talk so much shit about me on Twitter last season. Like, what, you know, blah, 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 and starts going off on me. And I'm like, you know what? I did. I talked shit about the character that you played on Survivor on television. And maybe it turns out you are that person in real life. But if you're not, I'd like to know the you that's not that person, because I talk shit about Will and about Rodney and about plenty of people who now I consider myself very friendly with, who I've met and who Will. They're lovely. I met Will and he was lovely in person. Great. I know Shireen's probably going to hate that. But literally, like, I have nothing bad to say about the guy because he was completely lovely and polite and cordial and kind when we met. And anyhow, Dan, I can't say the same for. So I don't know. I don't. So, like, we got into it a little bit.
At this point, I ran away like a child fleeing from his parents.
But also
arguing.
Because Dan's part, like, of Dan's
Shireen
argument.
Fleeing from Abby and PG.
Part of Dan's argument was like, well, Max was making fun of her too. Max was making fun of her too. And I was like, listen, Max and Shireen are friends. They're tight. Like, it's different to make fun of your friend. And then, like, when she got voted out, you were doing the Shireen hand up, you know, like, in solidarity. Like,
I
love
wept.
Shireen.
I wept.
So we, you know, it's different if, like, you want to make a comment about Shireen than if Dan Foley, who fucking berated her on national television, like, in a way that was so inappropriate. And, like, it just, like, I mean, the Jeff Probst
like how Abby
had
was
to,
treated.
No.
I'm just kidding. Absolutely did not Jeff Probst, by the way.
You know what, though? I will actually own up to the fact that I shouldn't have made a joke at her expense. I last night, when they swapped Shireen into the puzzle, and I went, oh, no. And then later on, when Rob was quizzing Dan about that, I said, Shireen is the person we swapped out of the puzzle, referring to that first challenge where she was having trouble and I went in. And that was insensitive of me because when I pushed Shireen aside. That was insensitive of me because last night was the night where Shireen, my friend, my closest ally from the game, and one of my closest friends from the entire experience really needed my support. And I went in for an easy laugh, and an easy laugh that made it seem like I was taking Dan Foley's side.
Yeah,
a lot of people came up to me afterwards and said that was out of line. And I at first said, oh, come on, I was just trying to be funny. And I thought about it overnight and I realized I probably was. The night your friend gets voted out is not the time to go for an easy laugh.
Right.
So I am owning up for the fact that I put my foot in my mouth last night, and I don't think Shireen is listening to this or watching, but I did apologize to her, and I want to apologize again because I think that on a night like last night, your friends need nothing but support.
I didn't
step up to the plate for her. I dropped the ball.
So anyhow, that's the backstory of what happened with Dan Foley.
Yeah, it was a pretty intense night. Listen,
it was.
Last time there was a live know-it-alls, I think it was Nina's boot episode, which
was like nothing happened.
It was very uneventful, very unsurprising.
Super uneventful. Oh,
and then last night, you get together 300-400 of the biggest Survivor fans in the universe, people who are Team Shireen through and through, and we watch her get voted out. It was tough.
It was very tough. It was very
upsetting.
It was
tough to see not only her, but also Spencer on the block.
I don't know.
Well.
Yeah, I'm less sad about Spencer's danger.
Okay, let's talk about that. How come? I would think Spencer would be right in the sort of demographic of wine and cheese.
I mean,
is it the Mitt Romney thing?
I mean,
I forgot about that. I completely forgot about that.
What?
That was like his idol or something on his bio, whatever.
Is he also, I mean, he's a fan, but is he like, he's not a nerd. Like, is he? Is he a nerd?
I don't know.
I think he's he is filling the nerd archetype. I mean, he's extremely athletic. He's great in challenges. But I think
he's a good-looking guy.
He's a
you have red wine in your beard.
That's
it's really distracting.
Oh,
beards are so gross.
Eliza,
obviously, part of my issue with Spencer is utter sour grapes at the archetype of the super fan doing a lot better than I did. Obviously,
what is it about Spencer that bothers you?
Yeah.
Honestly, the thing that I find the most annoying is that he's one of Jeff Probst's favorites. Like, okay. He's like, it feels jealous. Like they made a season for him to win. Like, before Steven left, I know, obviously, like, he's in way more trouble than we ever anticipated.
Yeah, that
but,
was
like, before
surprise.
Steven left, we literally sat down with him and we were like, just don't let Spencer walk to the end.
Vote out Spencer.
Just don't let Spencer walk this game to the final tribal council, because that's what we were like. We were just calling it. We were just like, they made this season has all of his, it has allies of his. He has the majority from his season. He's got this person, this person, this person. I mean, he's got more people from his season than anyone else.
Although last night was a pleasant surprise at seeing how quickly things turned on him.
Right.
That made me happy, because I felt like Cochran was never in that position in Caramel.
Right. And so, like, now if there's a turnaround, like, we can actually feel good about it. You know, I guess. But like, it just felt... I don't know. Somehow, like, the way that CBS kind of plays favorites with people, it, like, turns me against those people rather than making me root for them. Yes.
I'd like to meet Spencer, and I'd like to get to know him.
Oh, when I met him, I really liked him.
I bet I would like him
as a
person. I really
liked him in person.
I think I would.
I don't know if I love the character that they make him on the show.
The character of Spencer on the show, I just feel like this idea that he has to be like, last time I thought people were like chess pieces, and now I've learned that people are like people, so I will make connections to people. We are connecting with you. And I'm like...
Well, let's talk about that, actually, because that is an instance of something I'm seeing a lot in this season, where I feel like producers are asking contestants to specifically talk about their past using the party line terminology that's consistent with the edit and the official backstory. Mm-hmm. Terry, last time your social game wasn't as strong. Can you talk a little bit about how your social game is going to factor into your strategy this season? Right. And then Terry not only talks about it, but the light bulb goes off over his head and he goes out and acts on it. So I think there is at play here, this external factor. It's not producer manipulation, but it's people who recognize what their redemption arc is and start to carry it out, play into it, not just give it lip service like Abby, who says, if this were the Philippines Abby, I would have gone apeshit, and then she goes apeshit. But the people who actually are thinking about transforming their approach to playing the game and being thoughtful about it.
Abby was, you know, trying, maybe not successful, but she was cognizant of it.
Also, I think that, you know, the thing that you're saying is, like, it's so characteristic of a returning player season where, like, if you know what to look for when the producers are questioning you, if you know that the questions are actually answers and you can look into them and try to figure out what they're saying to you, and they're like, so Eliza, like, it seems that you and Parvati have had a rivalry since day one. Like, what do you think about that? And I'm like, that bitch is trying to vote me out. I'm like, yes, Parvati and I do have a rivalry, you know, like, and it's like, but they're giving it to you. They're like, you know, they're giving it to you even almost unintentionally or subliminally, like, you can pick it up. And when they're like, so, like, are you trying to improve your social game? Are you trying to connect with people? Yes, I am, you know, and it's like,
you don't just say it, but then you do it.
But you know what the best was? The best was Kelly Wigglesworth, how Jeff is like, Kelly, how often would you say you think about the game?
I know.
And you can just picture Kelly Wigglesworth answering like not at all.
Wait,
like,
in her pregame interviews, that's literally what she said.
I know it is.
Interviews, she was like, I don't think about it. I mean, I don't think about it.
You know that scene when, Kelly, can you tell us, 15 years ago, lost by one vote. How many times do you think about that tribal council? And Kelly was probably like, I'm basically over it. And he's like, would you say you think about it every day?
And she's like, I've thought about it. Would you say it's like a million
would
times?
You say like every
could you say
day,
you couldn't
though?
Count the number of times?
Like, would it be every day though?
And as unintelligent as she is, she picks up on it eventually. But someone like a Woo, does someone like a Woo have a capacity to
Bless his heart.
Does he have the capacity to read those
cues?
You know,
he has black belts.
I know. Did you know that Sierra voted out her mom? There are reasons why these people are on the show.
Woo is always going to be Woo.
Woo be Woo.
Go Woo Woo.
Woo.
All right, this needs to end.
They were trying to woo-woo. You were trying to get woo-woo to be a thing.
Me?
Who was trying to get woo-woo to be a thing last night? Someone was like, they need to woo-woo.
That sounds like a damn
story. Shireen and Spencer were trying to woo-woo. Brian, you get it?
That's actually not that bad.
the verb woo, to woo.
They're wooing woo.
They were trying to woo woo.
I get it now.
Yes.
I didn't at first.
I know. That's why you thought I was saying woo woo. And I was like, no, woo woo.
All right, they're pronounced the same. I'm going to go to the listener question.
Let's do it.
Because
I have to pack.
Yeah. Who has 0.0% chance to win this game? This is from Jesse playing Voodoo.
Abby.
Yeah, Abby.
Well, that was quick.
She can't win. She literally can't win. She can make it to the finals. But
well, actually,
that girl can't win.
Let me then make the question more difficult. Can you make it to the end and win towing Abby with you? Because a lot of people have talked about it. Abby's my goat. Varner says, I want to be there at the end with Abby. But is that a suicide plan?
Nope.
Can you go 39 days with her?
Nope. That's, I mean it's,
can you survive?
You want to kill yourself. Honestly, if someone did it with fucking Philip Shepherd, Abby Maria will be a fucking breeze. Philip Shepherd is way worse. I would take Abby 100 times out of 100 over Philip.
Brian?
I would over drown Phil? Myself.
Yeah, of course. I think I'd like Abby. I think Abby's Abby and I would have a ball of a time.
She's fun. She's fun. Yeah. I mean, she's kind of crazy, but she's fun.
I have a lot of fun with Abby hanging out there in LA. She's a great person off the island. Lovely, personable, just beautiful, fun soul. She doesn't seem
joyful
that pleasant
is the word
on the
wrote.
Show.
She goes, I'm a joy. No, she said, a joy. They find me a joy.
I think I would.
I don't think so, sweetheart, I love you.
The thing is, I think I'd get along with Abby, and I don't think I'd be the target of Abby's wrath. So I think I would be sitting in the Pete position or the Varner position of like, I'm good with you. Like, we don't have any problems.
Although, you know what's funny is like a lot of people have made the comparison between me and RC, and, you know, that I could potentially be that target for Abby.
And like, Shireen too, right?
Yeah. So and so the fact that like that I could be compared to those people that Abby has really not gotten along with, theoretically, I could have been someone she hated on the show. But I still think that you can win by dragging her to the end, a la Philip Shepherd. And I think that you don't necessarily lose points. I mean, it may be tough at some times, but I think, you know, you bring her along.
I'm gonna go to some more questions.
Okay, what do we got?
Let's see. Lisa, do you have any good questions for us?
There's one here from Mary Ditz, who has a question for Brian. Says, if he played again, would he play new school or old school?
And I'm going to repeat that on mic just so the listeners can hear. If Brian were to play again, would he play more of an old school game or a new school game?
I mean, if we're talking old school, like building shelters, that's not me. Like, I am old school in that I played in season 11, but I'm not building a shelter. I'm not building a fire. I like the new school mentality. I like the, like, hit the beach, let's play. Let's do this. I think my problem in the game is that I'm not the easiest person, I think, to immediately relate to because I don't really care about a lot of people. Potentially. So for me to connect with someone really quickly, I actually have to legit like them. So I think I fall into the, aww, I know.
We connected immediately. We were besties at first sight.
So I think I would fall into the new school category, even though I am an old school player, but I'd want to play new school with the old school people.
Let's talk about old school versus new school in general. Is that a false dichotomy? Is that BS? Because to me, Wu is old school, Varner's new school,
right,
based on how they play.
Yes, it's a false dichotomy. It's not new school, old school. It's Survivor, the way Survivor was kind of intended of, like, live in the island and build a community versus the strategy of the game. And that's really the dichotomy, not so much old versus new.
Yeah, because even someone like Eliza was playing new school Survivor in season 9.
Yeah,
do you consider yourself, like, thinking about your game, how it compares to these two paradigms?
It's
I was a beach
for,
person.
There
I was not
game,
a shelter person.
There yeah. for the game versus there for the experience of the island.
Yeah.
But why is that? Why I don't think
why are
that
they mutually exclusive?
Yeah,
they're not.
I mean,
well, that's old school. That's the old school mentality.
See, that's why I think I am old school. However, I'm not a shelter builder.
There's nothing about you that's old school.
Okay.
Except that I was on season 9.
Well, right. I mean,
like, that is like, that is as old school as we get these days. Everyone else is like dead. I'm kidding. I don't think anybody's
died. Too soon.
They're three.
BB? Just BB?
Three.
Oh, and Jen.
And also Caleb. Thanks,
Jen.
Moment of silence.
Jesus Christ.
There's three.
awful. I don't know why we had to talk about that. I'm sorry.
You heard it here, guys. Survivor, all the Fixins podcast. Going into the morbid topics in the Survivor universe. Yeah, let's change mood. Lisa,
question for us.
Eliza or Andrew's wife.
Ooh. You know, she was in South African Playboy or he's like something.
The most beautiful brunette I've ever seen, as if he needed that qualification. He's like, I actually have met hotter blondes. Redheads and hotter blondes.
Blondes. Like, blondes are really doing it for me, but she's the hottest brunette.
As far as brunettes, like she
can we get
like
a picture? Can somebody tweet us a picture, please?
I did look at Andrew's Facebook page, and his wife is very comely. She's very fetching.
I feel like the wife is off limits. Like, she didn't choose to be on the show.
No, of course not.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, and we're not going to talk shit about her. Right. I just want to answer the question. Andrew, I haven't seen her. I might think she's hotter than me. I don't know.
Andrew is an incredibly handsome guy. I mean, Andrew in his first
minus
season.
Minus the cold sore. Yikes. What are we supposed to pretend it wasn't there? Eating his face?
Listen, as someone who suffered from some sort of medical issue on Survivor, I don't talk about other people's growths. I was just going to say that Andrew looked a lot like Paul Newman in his first season, and it doesn't look like he's aged a day.
No,
since
he's aged very well.
I mean, we've got a lot of dad bod on this
season.
Yeah, but
they both aged phenomenally.
I know.
We should all be so lucky.
That story, though, you know, I think you can divide the universe, not into beach people, shelter people, old school, new school. People who cry when they hear Savage's story versus people who do the Eliza Orlins, roll their eyes.
Yeah.
Okay. I rolled my eyes.
Me too. We all did.
Are you kidding? I would have lost my
I would have cried if
mind.
She died.
Well, and I know Rob was
not to
very...
bring up death again. But like, honestly, I thought that's where the story was going. I was like, oh my God, he's telling this touching story about his wife.
It did.
And like, maybe...
Well, except that in episode one, he made the point of being like, I have a beautiful wife. My kids are fantastic.
But I thought
I'm
maybe
Captain
it was a new
America.
Wife. Maybe he was widowed and... Or widowed?
Widower.
Anyway.
This is really gone down a dark path.
Okay.
So, oh God, you're ready again?
Oscar, look at Oscar. Oh, he's on screen now.
Oscar.
At Oscar Orlins humping a pillow.
I would have lost my mind. I mean, it's the same thing for me in my season when my tribe was praying.
I know.
It's just like,
me
is there
too.
No one else here who doesn't want to do this? Just me?
Really? All we right, have to thank Jesus before we eat this coconut?
So if
Pass.
It was if it was just me there, I would have been like, that story, Andrew, that story is beautiful. I just, it's so beautiful. Tell me more. But if you had been there with me, at least I'd been like side eye. Like,
Liza, more uncomfortable, Ozzy and Amanda or Oscar in the pillow? Being witness, having witnessed both of those couplings.
I'll take Oscar any day.
Okay. Let's move on. Next question. You want to go another lap on that?
No.
No.
So then, at Baby Max says, create a hypothetical East Coast versus West Coast versus Middle America All Stars, six players each tribe.
Oh. Ooh.
Oh God. Okay. Should we? Okay.
East Coast.
What are our limitations? Is it people?
East Coast. Yeah. No. East Coast is all. Is
it's exclusively New York.
East Coast is exclusively New York.
Wine and cheese versus
wine
kale and
cheese
yoga versus
kale and yoga
versus God and Guns.
Versus God and Guns.
Max, that was well done.
Max.
Mike Holloway leading up God and Guns.
Mike Holloway leading up God and Guns.
Liza, you or Missy?
Ugh, no, nobody wants to see them on the show
Colby.
Again.
You get Colby on there. You could get some other great Texans.
Like Laura Morick could be
Laura
like
Morick,
on
but she's,
God and Guns.
She's technically from Oregon, though.
She is.
Whatever. She's God and Guns.
She's certainly.
Well, listen, if Haley could be no collar being a lawyer, Laura Morick could be God and Guns.
Right, Haley
so
is not a lawyer.
Like, middle of
she's not a lawyer.
Law student.
Yeah. Okay.
Who's Middle America? We could get. I mean, do you get some?
I feel like you gotta rule out Chicago.
Twyla. Let's get some Twyla in there.
Is it Rory from Iowa or something like that?
Who? Rory.
Rory.
He was from Iowa, wasn't he?
Yeah, I don't think.
Grown ass man.
He's a grown ass man.
Butch from Amazon was from downstate
Illinois. Southern Illinois. Mm-hmm.
What about from Survivor China, like Jamie?
Jamie is from
Carolina,
the South.
Technically East Coast.
North Carolina's.
But that should,
South
they could be gods. They could be gods.
South Carolina could be gods and guns.
Gods and guns. So
well, Jamie works in casting now, though.
Yeah, true. Okay, so now let's do kale and yoga.
So you gotta have like Julie Berry.
Julie Berry.
She can't go back on.
Nope.
Julie Berry.
Shane.
Shane.
Vetus.
Vetus again.
I want to see Vetus play more.
Parvati lives here now, but I feel like she's more kale.
Parv is definitely kale and yoga. Yeah, she's a New York temporary.
We have so many survivors in LA.
Yeah, LA's got its plethora of survivors. Who are the six from us?
Yeah, who's
the six from us?
Sophie. Eliza Bryan.
Gotta be us.
Fishback.
The question was asked to us, so I'm putting myself in it.
That's four of us. We only get two more.
Fishback and two more.
Franny. Even though she would never do it again.
You would have to kidnap her to bring her back out.
Yeah, she would not.
Oh my God. What
if she went back and played and won?
Yeah, I know.
And Tony Vlachos, just to mix it up.
Oh, he's Jersey.
Tony.
He's Jersey. God, we're in jerseys.
Or, but also we could pick Rodney if we wanted a Boston boy.
Oh,
or
Rodney.
Amy. For my season.
Well, you know what we really need? What we really need is New York versus Boston versus
New York, Boston, LA
versus Texas.
And what we really need is another version of Brains versus Bronze versus Beauty.
Yes.
Because Brains, Bronze, Beauty and Worlds Apart weren't enough. We're doing Brains, Bronze, Beauty 2 next season. Right. And then we'll do
Gods. I keep hearing they're going to do Brains, Bronze, Beauty
3?
No, 2. Next season is Brains, Bronze, Beauty.
Oh, next season. But that's with new people.
Yes, correct.
I heard they're going to do Brains, Bronze, Beauty
with Returners.
All-Stars.
This is like a rumor that probably was made up in someone's mind.
Yeah, I think that's just something
Colby
that people
said
like
that
to
while
do.
He was masturbating the Outback, actually.
did we have any confirmation on that? Did Colby, in fact, go out back to take
I
one?
I can't imagine that happening.
To shrimp on the Joe's shrimp
know,
on the Barbie.
Do we know of anyone who did that on Survivor?
Rubbed one out?
Yes.
No.
I did on the pre-jury trip, but I mean,
but not on the
no
game.
When, on the show though, you're like. So dirty.
No. The first thing,
and not in like the hot way.
The first thing that goes when you have no food or sleep is your sex drive. Mm-hmm. I remember being out there and thinking like, oh God, I can't even imagine.
Yeah, well,
and not because I'm gross and dirty, but because like your body is breaking
you
down.
Yeah, you have
need
no
the water.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Do we have any other questions?
We have lots of other questions.
Oh, she is pretty. Look
yeah,
at her.
Yeah, she is. She's gorgeous.
But she looks
and
old.
And he's handsome.
No, stop it. She's a beautiful woman. She didn't ask to be on the show.
Yeah,
we don't
okay.
We don't
listen,
comment on her.
We don't.
No, listen. I'm not. Nothing bad to say
the
about
The only
her.
Thing that we have against Andrew Savage is that he has picked a good friend of ours, someone who we love and believe is a great person, to be the target of his ire.
Well, and also he's just kind of a douche.
All the Fixins. Hashtag Survivor ATF. Okay. Any more questions, Lisa?
There's Fat Tyson. Should Jason Siska get a second chance?
That's all you.
Hell yeah.
God, what happened to that kid? Isn't he like the Virgin Islands?
Yeah, he's killing it. He like is like a mountain man living in like a little shack in on St. John. I don't know. He's got a girlfriend. He lives with his girlfriend. He teaches and he like runs a boat company and he like owns a boat and he takes people out on tours around the British Virgin Islands. He goes to Virgin Gorda and all the places. I mean, he's like awesome.
Jason Siska?
Yeah, I see
he
him.
He should
like,
be on Below Deck. That show is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So he should be on any
you guys,
show
Jeff
other
Pittman,
than Survivor.
Jeff Pittman has a question for
Jeff
us.
Pittman of
True
Dark
Times. But I don't, okay.
I don't get it, actually.
Is there any numbers loophole a 2-7 minority can use to save both people? Is a 9-plus person tribe too big?
So what could Shireen and Spencer have done at
to save
all
themselves?
To save themselves besides having an idol, obviously?
Talk to Wu before day 6?
Well, the thing is they thought they were in the majority. Like, the problem they had was they didn't know they were in the minority until it was too late. So...
And I think that last night illustrated something that was very characteristic of my Survivor experience. You could be playing a perfect game that is completely disconnected from the reality that you're playing within and is in fact a horrible game.
Yeah.
But in the little illusory reality that you've created in your mind where you've got this alliance, you've got the numbers, you think you're sitting pretty. So you stop playing,
you stop
scrambling, you stop striving.
Right.
The thing that I've learned from talking to people like Mike from my season is that even when Mike had the numbers, every day he went person to person to check how everyone was to gauge the temperature.
That's why paranoia is your friend on Survivor. So for example, at final 8 in Vanuatu, basically, Chad had like laid it into Julie really hard after they voted out Sarge.
Chad
Crittenden, and he was like, Julie,
love
like
Chad.
I can't believe you did this to me. Like, you know, we like got to be such good friends after we were, you know, on Le Pevy together. And Julie, he like guilt tripped her pretty hard about the whole thing. And he knew he was the next to go because Chris was never going to win a challenge. So we thought. And so he basically was like, Julie, like, please just don't write my name down. Like, why don't you just throw a vote somewhere else? Like maybe to Eliza or somebody who we don't think deserves to be here. They would always use that bullshit line, deserves to be here. Fuck you. You know? And she was like, yeah, okay. You know, and she kind of like bought into that. And thankfully I'm the most paranoid person in the world. And I'm like, okay, we're all definitely doing this. We're voting for this. This is what we're doing. Right. And Julie was like, well, you know, I was thinking maybe I was going to write your name down. I hope that's okay. Right. Like, I mean, you're not going home, so I'm just going to write your name down. And I was like, Julie, are you insane? I was like, they could literally vote me out if you write my name down. Like they can all just change, you know, like I can get voted. I flipped out on her. I was like, you cannot write my name down under any circumstances. Do not write my name down. Blah, blah, blah. And I was like, you have to vote Chad. If you don't, this whole plan could be ruined. You know, women to the end is going to be completely fucked up. Blah, 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 blah. And she was like, okay. Didn't write my name down. You know, and we had a whole discussion at tribal council that night. Like basically Twyla and Scout were like contemplating forcing a tie because they misunderstood the rules of a tie because some people don't know how to read a contract. And so I sat there explaining it, you know, or Jeff explained it in addition because I was like, guys, if you force the tie, the two people who have been voted for will then be immune. And the rest of you assholes pick rocks, not us, you. And they were like, oh, we better not force a tie and like voted Chad out, you know, but like I was actually at risk. And had I not been like going around being like, okay, this is what we're doing. You're not voting for me. Like I might've gone home.
Yeah.
Just on a fluke almost.
I remember from our season, the episode where Mike comes up to Sierra and Carol and he says, who's in the shelter? Who's sleeping? Who's comfortable? Who's not scrambling? Yeah. That's how you know where the lions lie.
Yeah.
Totally. First of all, Brian
Corridan,
who
will quit a challenge for food?
Sun's out, guns out. And Eliza, your dog is really getting amorous and moved on from the pillow to Brian.
I know. They're in love.
Any other questions? Any other pressing questions?
Who gets Eliza's eye roll of the night Are You May Ray?
Who gets my eye roll of the night?
Yeah.
Give a good eye roll.
Oh.
From the episode.
Savage. Oh, and yeah. That ridiculous story. I mean, come on.
I know. Oh.
I mean, honestly, or Jeremy, to be perfectly honest.
No,
like,
Jeremy was no, fine.
Grown men crying on Survivor is just like not that.
Pregnant.
Oh my God. Plenty of men have pregnant wives. They don't fucking cry about it.
But they're all not on Survivor.
I don't know.
I give Jeremy a pass. Savage can suck a neck.
Jeremy, I like Jeremy.
Yeah, let's,
I do like
stand on Jeremy because I love me some Jeremy.
I really like Jeremy. I liked him his first season. I loved the him and Josh dynamic. I thought they were like the strongest people. And then
I like
Jeremy. I was very upset that the two of them didn't make it to the end because they both deserve to. Speaking of deserve, you know.
Yeah, right.
Here's a question that I have. And this is a question that touches upon our friend Stephen Fishback.
Fishbach.
What is the deal with guys who wear loose fitting boxer shorts on Survivor? Now, I know Vitas got a lot of shit last week.
Vitas knew what Vitas was doing.
Well, listen, and I don't remember if I told this story on the podcast last weekend, but when I sent in my wardrobe for Second Chances, I sent in the same exact color underwear that I wore the first season, and they sent it back to me and said, can you wear something more fun, with a fun pattern?
I'm sorry, this is too much.
It's okay. No, listen, this is not a family-friendly podcast. Yeah, we warned people before. Perfect timing for the conversation about crotch framing.
Yes, seriously.
But I was told to supply some more colorful underwear this time. Vitas got the same.
Yeah, Vitas said his underwear all got rejected.
And
that's
too
boring.
And he found a colorful pair, and that pair, unfortunately, in the edit at least, played into his downfall. But I'm looking at Steven, and Steven's boxers are looking saggy. They're not tight. They're not fitted.
But that's not Steven's story. Steven's story isn't, look at that ass. Steven's story is like, oh, this kid, right?
I guess. I mean, I don't know. Eliza, do you have an opinion on the loose-fitted? Joe is wearing the loose-fitting boxers.
If
Joe wore the tight boxers, he'd go from 10,000 Instagram followers to 20, I think.
Wait, aren't Joe's tight?
No, Joe wears the loose ones.
What are they?
He's got the loose things on.
That's I can't picture them either. I know.
I can't picture Joe's boxer.
Am I the only one who's paying attention to all of the men's boxer shorts?
Are you sure? Because if I were casting director, I would for sure be like, Joe, we need you in the tightest underwear possible.
Yeah, you'd put Joe in Dan Foley's bikini briefs.
Mankini.
Yeah.
Loose boxers? That's stupid of casting. That's a missed opportunity, obviously.
Well, I don't think casting does the...
We've got photo evidence here.
Oh, those aren't that loose.
They're like tight-ish, I guess.
They're not like tight like Vetus's.
It's not Vetus. Wow, that was quick, by the way.
Well, she just had that cute.
that's actually your background, I'm pretty sure.
Man. I had a few other things that I wanted to bring
why
up.
Why is Savage touching himself in that picture?
I feel like that's Savage's go-to pose.
I mean, can
crotch
we, like,
framing?
Can you like hold
isn't
this
that
to the,
basically
the
what
the
his
camera?
Whole story was? Just one giant touching himself?
No, it's still not clear. Back it up. I don't know if it's gonna be clear. Oh well. Go to Joe's Instagram.
Let me just briefly go through these notes. I have like these cryptic notes like Varner, gay Fred Flintstone.
Oh, because of the purple shirt and the green tie.
Yes.
Nailed it.
I have Steven and Joe, Goofus and Gallant. Do you guys remember Goofus and Gallant from
Obviously Highlights
magazine.
My mom would be like, Brian, be a Gallant. Yeah. Don't be a Goofus.
It's like, Joe makes fire. Steven looks for an idol. Joe makes hammocks for his tribe members. Steven casts aspersions on virtuous Jeremy.
Casts aspersions.
Yes. Actually, speaking of casting aspersions, I had a question posed by one of the listeners. Thoughts on Cass?
I love her. A+. Cass. Check plus. What's not to love?
Most things.
What?
I don't know, but she's been so like she's like playing like a UTR game. Like I don't know what
to do. I could have done without the like. Oh, I'm really like touched by the story, Cass.
I know.
Cass.
I know. But you know what? If that's part of her game, like, but talk about changing.
It seemed like she was genuinely touched by living with someone she actually likes, as opposed to the buffoons on Luzon.
Yep, and just. To be clear, because I have a reputation for disliking Cass, I love Cass on the show. I voted for her on every ballot that I cast for myself. I also voted for her. I want to see Cass on Survivor.
Can we ask who your cast was?
Who voted for?
Who was your vote?
I obviously voted for all the people from Worlds Apart, knowing I was throwing away my votes for Mike.
Okay.
I voted for...
So I threw away my Mike votes, too.
That's three guys and two women.
I think I voted for...
Brian is an insane mind.
Both Terry and Savage, knowing that they would probably not both get on.
Were you voting for him?
Did I vote for Savage?
I can't actually
sure
remember.
I
don't know if
Savage.
I was voting for Savage. I was definitely voting for Terry.
I played the party line of old school. If you were on the show before season 20, I voted for you.
Shit, I think I probably
My
was.
My concerns were Brad, Jim, Woo,
Who's right, Brad?
Brad Culpepper.
Oh, he was on the ballot. No, I definitely did not vote for him.
I absolutely did not vote for him.
I did not vote for those people.
I voted for Jim Rice.
I saw them as being the 10 to 15 or 10
to
16.
He really, really wanted it.
I love Jim Rice.
Yeah. I mean, and Donald Trump really, really wants to be president.
And that's why I'm voting for him.
Me too. Never, never, never. Listeners.
I want to hear his policies.
Cass, one thing that Cass is doing exceptionally well is, like we were talking about with Terry, owning her narrative.
Uh-huh.
In a much more convincing way than Spencer is. That said, no one in Bayonne really has shown us enough for us to evaluate them. I think Steven probably has had the most confessionals on Bayonne right now.
Well, certainly has the most narrative on Bayonne.
Right? And I love that because, you know, after the first episode, while everyone was freaking out, if you stopped and contemplated what we'd seen a lot of Steven.
Yes.
And better that than
Kimmy
or Monica or Sierra. Yeah. I mean, every week I have to write out the names of all the people on the show in the tags field on YouTube. And I get to a certain point where I can't remember Sierra.
I
know she really has gotten no airtime. Monica's gotten no airtime,
but I remember she's on there because I voted like mad for her.
Me too.
Her video convinced me.
I know she's so
she
awesome.
Had a video and I was like, I wasn't gonna vote for you. I am now. And I did vote for her.
Yeah. I was voting for her because she's my friend.
One of my picks.
I love her.
I ranked her number one. And I'm in Monica's case, I think being UTR for Monica best place she could possibly be. Monica's the one who's going to be standing when everyone else has knocked themselves out of the game.
Yeah, Monica's right where Monica needs to be.
All right, let's do one more question. Lisa, we got anything good? Actually, you know what? I got one here. You look for one more from David.
Okay, and then that has to be the last one.
The Gordo. Do you think Varner is getting the quote-unquote Stephen Fishback trademarked winner's edit? If not, who is?
Wait, why is the Stephen Fishback trademark?
You mean because Stephen always uses that term in know-it-alls.
Oh, not that Stephen Fishback.
He always says,
I was like, Stephen never got a winner's edit. I love him, but no.
Oh, Varner is absolutely getting a winner's edit. Right now? Are you kidding me? Yes. Varner is the one who's like controlling the game. The narrative is Varner's. He's the one giving the confessionals. He's got a winner's edit. No one on Bayonne has a winner's edit because no one on Bayonne is featured. So in Takeo, Terry. Varner and Terry.
Terry, yeah.
Because Terry's edit, the whole Jeff, you know, his
redemption edit. Redemption.
Is we need to see someone win this season who has learned from their mistakes and is here to fix them. And that's what Terry and to a degree Varner is doing.
Yep.
Are doing. Mm-hmm. And Kelly Wentworth. Kelly Wentworth too. For
Kelly's
women.
Getting
Kelly
a
is
winner
getting,
edit.
Getting a winner's edit.
Because women don't get winner edits in the same way.
That men do.
But she's getting, you know, part she's of the edit or a whatever, like idol finding, smart.
The best
you know.
Edits right now are Terry Varner and Kelly Wentworth.
I agree.
Uh-huh. Lisa, you got one for us?
So you've answered most of the questions that have been sent in. Do you think at all what Abby does is intentional and strategic?
Absolutely not.
No. I don't think so either.
Not for a hot second, no. No, Abby is just Abby and that's Abby and she's doing what she can to try to fix it, but she can't. I loved how she was like, I heard you. Like, I heard you talking about me. And PG was like,
There was one moment, though, where Abby was so self-reflexive and so great where she said, I'm going to go up there and break up that conversation.
Yeah,
I'm just going to go be annoying.
With Terry and Wu.
Oh, yeah.
And that was brilliant.
And then Terry, I think it's clear she really grates on Terry.
Yeah.
Well, which is, I mean, of course, then he's the one
to go comfort her. It's so funny. I know, but she clearly grates on him because he was like, oh, yeah, you could follow me around all day. Like, yeah. I
Terry,
run faster than you do.
Terry
I don't
said
know.
Something that they bleeped out, and that is not a Terry move to curse. So they bleeped something about Terry. He's like, shit happens that you don't need to know about, and they bleeped the first word.
Yeah, young lady.
Uh-huh. Interesting that you had that. Also interesting what we heard last week, Shireen's behind the scenes story about,
although other people deny that it's
deny
really
it
weird.
What story? I don't know it.
The Shireen alleges that when the first tree mail came, Abby started reading it.
Oh,
the font story. On the tree mail was
although
very
Stephen wrote in his blog like, oh, I didn't want to, like, Abby doesn't speak English that well, you know. I mean, whatever. I mean, he didn't. I don't think people say it in a negative way. Yeah, her English is fine. She's not a native speaker.
There are things that a Stephen Fishback can get away with that a Captain America Terry Dietz can't.
Special
weird,
sucks.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the kind of thing like you'd think anybody would get crucified for, but
we don't say crucified.
Crucified.
We don't say that on the podcast.
Crucified. Hands nailed, cross, dead Jesus.
Stigmata.
Okay. One last segment.
Well, the story. So the story, the quick recap of the story. I don't even know what we're talking about.
That Abby reads the tree mail. Abby reads the tree mail.
Oh, right. Okay.
And Terry said something allegedly along the lines of like, can't someone read the tree mail who
speaks English?
Speaks English properly.
Someone who speaks English.
I thought
English.
He wanted more explanation of the story of Jesus on the cross.
No.
Okay, thanks.
No, Pilate. That is not what she was asking. No.
Mike, I'm sorry. I did not.
No. So Terry allegedly told Abby that, allegedly said, can someone who speaks English read this tree mail? And, you know, that's the story. Who knows if it's true? Shireen says it, so that's what I'm reporting.
So one last segment before we wrap for the night. It's a segment we do every week. And every week, this is the second week of the podcast. It's a segment called Your Mother's a Whore.
Great. Fantastic.
And it is where we weigh in on what we think was the moment in the episode that one castaway will regret for the rest of his or her life. Much like Dan Foley will regret for the rest of his life calling Rodney's mother a whore.
I thought it was a Celebrity Jeopardy reference.
No,
your mother's a whore. Trebek.
Turd Ferguson.
Yeah, Turd Ferguson. No, it is a reference to the moment that earned
I'll
Dan
take
Foley.
The rapist for 400, Alex.
The penis mightier.
I'll take the penis mightier.
Swords.
You know the moment I'm referring to, the moment that was shown to us during the reunion with behind the scenes footage of Dan.
Yes, with the cameraman in the photo.
Wait, right? How awesome this is that for the rest autistic of your life. Paralegal? Have you been watching Jeopardy?
No, I'm a couple episodes.
Oh my god!
Don't spoil it.
Okay, I won't. Oh my god, we're Jeopardy nerds. Okay. Sorry.
So
that's for a whole nother podcast. Moments,
by the way, does Dan Foley actually regret that moment? Does he have a sense of regret?
Does he?
I actually.
I'm sad that I know his name, by the way, because I don't care for him. At least the character he played on TV.
Dan, I think, is a guy who is seriously committed to making amends. And I think that last night he said a lot of things that indicated that he is on the right path.
Okay.
And that he regrets the fact that he called Rodney's mother a whore. I mean, listen, I would not want to be on Rodney's bad side. And Rodney's mother is a lovely lady. And again, I wouldn't want to be on Rodney's bad side.
Wait, are they still, is he still on Rodney's bad side?
No, but I would never want to be on Rodney's bad side. Actually, Rodney was supposed to come last night.
I know, I was
fun
so
story.
Sad.
Dan picked up Rodney. They got in the car, started driving to New York, 15 minutes outside of Boston. Rodney got a phone call. This hurricane, the rain, my roof is leaking. You got to come over and fix this roof. Rodney's a roofing contractor. The hurricane's name?
Joaquin.
Swing arms in unison.
Oh.
So what is the moment from this episode that a contestant will regret for the rest of his or her life?
Stop it, Oscar. Stop. It's enough. It's enough.
Lord, buddy. Talk about stamina. The moment someone will regret.
Well, I think it wasn't aired. I think it wasn't aired, apparently.
Which
from
one?
That Shireen, the way that Shireen explains the how this really went down. Like, basically, they were fully prepared to vote out Spencer.
Oh, and then how
she put herself in a situation where Varner decided to
switch
it to her.
So you think Shireen is the one who's having how poetic.
Shireen is going to regret it.
Yeah, and
I don't know that Shireen's my pick, though. I feel like I have another pick. I just don't know.
I don't know. I just feel like it didn't air on the episode, so like it's hard. But I know that Shireen feels very regretful of the way that it all went down. And so I feel like, you know, especially in her all of her exit interviews, she talks about the fact that like that alliance was not going to target her first.
No.
She is not the person. They were going to target Spencer. They were going to vote for Spencer. And she went to bat for Spencer and really tried to turn the tides and then target Varner and say, Varner's flipping on you guys. And then tried to bring over the other old schoolers and or new schoolers, whatever we're calling them. I don't even know.
And shelter.
And then they decide to change the vote and vote her out instead. And that's like, I think.
And that's a storyline that I regret they didn't explore.
I don't understand why they wouldn't show that.
Because Survivor oversimplifies.
Apparently,
right,
she had a whole blow up when she was voted out. She says this the interview with Dalton Ross, how when she was voted out, she started calling people out and she was like,
and Jeff
Terry
just let
has
her
the idol, and she was just telling this whole fabricated story about how Terry has the idol. And Jeff Varner was like, "Wait, how do you know that?" She's like, "I saw him. I caught him. He's got the idol.
He was
Terry
burying
idol,
it." And she like told this whole thing after her. Like Jeff was snuffing
but it was
her
all
torch,
edited out.
And they didn't show any of that.
Here's the thing that
I guess
take
it doesn't
away from
play a role
this
in this season. Otherwise,
it doesn't
they would have
play
to show
a role in the season. Right. And they're focusing on these arcs of character growth development. Mm-hmm. Shireen. The thing that people didn't see last season is that Shireen is an aggressive gamer. And the reason why she was voted out this time is not because she was insensitive, not because she didn't play a good social game, because she played an aggressive game and went after Varner, a guy who
I think that was pretty clear. They were voting for Shireen or Spencer because they were too aggressive. That was
well,
the story.
But they
were
specifically pursuing
Shireen rather than Spencer.
Well, no, Shireen was specifically going after Varner.
Right.
Oh, that we didn't see.
Well, that's what Shireen talked about in her exits today.
Right.
That as soon as she got wind that Varner wanted to flip back to the shelter people.
He flipped on us. He flipped on you. Let's vote him out.
Let's vote him out. It got back to Varner, and Varner just had a little more pull with a few more people and was able to say, oh, is that so, Shireen? And put the target back on her. But let's be clear here, because I think that Shireen deserves this. Shireen was not voted out because she failed to come to Abby's defense. She was not voted out because she was a poor social gamer who hadn't made a strong bond with Wu. She was voted out because she made an aggressive strategic gambit. She took a chance going after the guy who had all of the power, and she went out guns blazing. And I'm proud of her. I'm proud of how she played. A lot of people are being extremely critical of her right now, and I think some people might have gotten the impression last night that I was too. But the Shireen who I aligned myself with was not Shireen the victim. It was Shireen the gamer.
Yeah. So she's a gamer.
Your mother's a whore. Not your mother. Your mother's a very lovely woman. What is the moment that you think someone will be regretting? Or actually, Brian, you...
Yeah, because you've answered. Answered. Maybe Spencer crying over having to butt off Shireen. We get it. It's hard.
And Tony Vlachos, we saw some texts between the two of them. Tony... asked Spencer, quote, are you a vagina?
Oh, okay.
I'm putting you on timeout.
Come on. Now that makes me like Spencer more.
It's day six and you're crying.
That's silly.
Oh, I love the relationship between those two.
I don't understand. I don't know it. So I...
All right.
Are they actually friends or is
Tony... Fireside chats. Yeah, he has fireside chats. I think Tony's okay.
Okay.
And
I remember when Tony blocked me during their season because I was tweeting mean things about him, and it's like, dude, come on. I'm tweeting about a character you're playing on TV. Like, it's fine. Like, get over yourself. And then Russell Hance bullied him into unblocking me. It was like the very greatest good. Night ever.
So my pick is Savage. Savage going after Fishback. And this is strictly intuition. No spoilers. I think Fishback gets the final word. Or at least I hope so.
Oh, I fucking hope so.
I think Fishback finds that idol.
I hope so.
And plays it and gets Savage out.
Oh, I hope
lilled.
So.
Savage gets lilled.
Steven is
nothing
the new
will
make me
happen. Savage getting lilled twice.
And Steven being the new lil. Get him in a Boy Scout uniform.
Let's go, Steven.
I don't know if Steven aspires
let's
to be
Let's go, Steven.
But I mean, he
I do
does
feel
he
like
want to be the,
go,
does Steven want to be the new Cochran or does he want to be the new lil?
No, he wants to be the new Steven.
I don't know. Lil's pretty cool.
All right, guys. With that, we'll wrap up. I'm going to thank our host, Eliza Orlins, and Brian Corridan, our other guest.
Thank you for coming to New York.
The Wine and Cheese Alliance.
Yeah.
It's always a pleasure, guys. I love you guys. I love hanging out. And I think that we definitely will have some people talking about this in the next few days.
Oh, dear.
Anything else to say about Jesus or death?
Or BB or people's family members or...
Vanessa should have won Big Brother. That's just something I needed to say.
Amen.
Yeah.
And I'm not religious. I don't know why I said amen. I never say amen.
All right, guys. Haven't worked out next week's guest yet, but we will definitely let you know as soon as we do. In the meantime, tweet at us. SurvivorATF is the hashtag. My Twitter is FYMaxwell.
E. Orlins.
And Bri Corridan.
And use that Bri Corridan to let Survivor tweet that you are ready to see someone from Guatemala come back, and specifically, you're ready
to see
Brian Corridan come back.
Hell yeah.
All right, guys. Thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.
Bye.
Thanks, guys.
Wait.
What?
You can follow Oscar at Oscar Orlins.
At Oscar Orlins. And the pillow, does the pillow have a Twitter account?
Not yet, but I'm sure someone's going to create one.
Oscar's pillow. Oh, and Oscar, he's laying it. God, this guy never stops.
Oscar, you.
Whatever you're feeding him,
no,
I need.
No, honestly, he's not usually like this. It's the company.
He's absolutely like this all the time.
No, he isn't.
All the time.
He goes at that blanket like Kobe went at the entire
yeah,
Australia.
He's like Kobe in the outfit.
Please.
Somebody has to tweet us whether
please,
confirmation
if you're still
of this.
Listening.
Kolby Donaldson.
Did Kobe enjoy some alone time?
Some me time.
Some onanism.
Onanism. Well done. O-N-A-N-I-S-M. Onanism.
Ooh. Good
what
word.
What was the word that I used earlier? He'll know it. You're an SAT coach. Vituperate.
We used all the... We...
Vituperate. To yell at. To curse at. To scold harshly. Vituperate.
And there was a lot of...
Vituperation. Vituperation.
On Reddit today toward Shireen. I guess the final
invective.
Word... Invective. The final word we'll say is we love
some
you,
good
Shireen.
Words. There are a bunch of good words on this
aspersion
podcast.
Aspersion you used.
We love you, Shireen. We love you, Steven. We love Spencer, Kelly, all of our friends who are still in the
Steven.
Game. Keep hope
we
alive.
Love Steven.
I love Kelly. I love Varner. I love Kelly
we
Wigglesworth.
We love you, Varner.
Varner.
And I love Terry.
Love Terry.
We
and
love
PG's
Survivor,
awesome.
Right? We love Survivor.
And Monica.
We love Survivor and Monica.
And Monica.
She's playing an INV game right now.
I could do without some of the other people. Keith, I could do without.
I feel like we're on the after show now.
Yeah, the after show.
All right. Good night, guys.
Night.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.